Imagine a future where instead of using your hands to control electronic devices, you could control them by simply thinking about it. A world where instead of sending someone a text message, you could send them a thought. What if instead of interacting with data on a two-dimensional screen, it could be overlaid as virtual 3D objects in your environment? The field of neurotechnology, while still very much in its infancy, will make this possible and dramatically change the way we interface with computers. And if you believe people like Elon Musk, it may even one day provide a basis for humanity to merge with artificial intelligence. Who knows? Someday, you may even get an implant to make you smarter than Einstein. Hi, I'm Colin Fosna, and in this video, we're going to broadly discuss the field of neurotechnology and brain-computer interfacing, their uses, and ethical implications. Neurotechnology is any device that images or stimulates the brain, and brain-computer interfaces, or BCIs, take this concept a step further to control external computers and machines. Research published in 2018 showcased a BCI which allowed participants to engage with an Android tablet and use several common applications, including typing, searching the web, sending emails, watching YouTube videos, and checking the weather. Throughout this course, we will jump between the two concepts, but understand that BCIs are a more specific subset of neurotechnology. We may still be several decades away from being able to send someone else a thought, but despite the massive amounts of work left to do in the field, neurotechnology is able to accomplish advanced tasks such as controlling robotic arms, or even basic computer control. The groundwork for these devices has been laid since as early as the late 90s, where researchers used small metal objects called electrodes to read signals from the brain. This provided a means for robotic arms to be controlled by mice by monitoring the areas of the brain associated with movement. Studies such as these were trailblazers for their time. And as the growth of electronics, namely computers, accelerated, the number of ways neurotechnology could be used has grown dramatically. One of the most important developments within the neurotechnology field is how much we've learned about the brain. The Human Connectome Project, for example, was a pioneering study in which brain scanning technologies mapped the brain. This project has significantly improved our understanding of how the brain works, and it's a great example of how developing neurotechnology has changed the way that we study the mind. As our understanding of the brain improved, we found more ways to use these devices to improve the quality of life for many people. We found it was possible to improve rehabilitation for individuals with strokes, restore hearing loss, vision, and even allow for people who are paralyzed to walk again. As electronics continue to improve in complexity, we will undoubtedly make many breakthroughs and continue to help people in new, exciting ways. There are many uses for neurotechnology. Whether it's for cognitive enhancement, brain research, alleviating symptoms of illness, modulating pain, or even improvements to existing technologies, such as robotic prosthetics, we're very clearly just at the emergence of this amazing technology. Cognitive enhancement, the ability to, quote, upgrade the brain, while previously only in the realm of science fiction, appears to be close to science fact in the field of neurotechnology. Neurostimulation, the ability to directly send signals to the brain using electronics, could be used to improve the performance in human perception, learning, memory, attention, and decision-making. Several studies have laid the groundwork for humans to someday possess superhuman cognitive abilities, and neurotechnology could be the key to unlocking this. It's likely that in the future, we will be able to treat cognitive disorders such as reading disabilities using neurotechnology, and some devices can already be used to treat dyslexia. While wearing a device, participants were asked to read through several sentences. The device was shown to improve reading speed significantly compared to when the participant was not wearing the device. For people who struggle with reading, this device could really change the way they learn new information. These stimulating devices can help people struggling with dyslexia, but they can also be used to improve the way that people learn. Improvements in the ability to learn and retain information have been made using neuroprosthetics. Neuroprosthetics artificially restore parts of the brain or body which have been damaged or underdeveloped. Some of these devices have the potential for improving memory, and may even allow for us to read minds. Amazingly, researchers were able to stimulate the hippocampus, which is the area of the brain that deals with memory, and allow for the transfer of memory between two animals. So, in a roundabout way, it's literally possible to read an animal's mind. But not only is there potential for these devices to improve cognitive abilities, it's also been found that it may be possible to directly influence human behavior using neurotechnology. That is to say, it may be possible to change someone's mood. In one study, researchers found that stimulation of the prefrontal cortex, an area of the brain involved with evaluating risks and benefits, resulted in participants exhibiting much riskier decision-making behaviors. Having control over human decision-making is very powerful, and we have to consider ethics when developing devices like this. We will cover these topics further on throughout this course. The ability to augment the way we think may just be the beginning for neurotechnology. It may be possible to develop ways to experience completely new senses with the use of brain-computer interfaces. Theoretically, you may be able to tap directly into the optic nerve to allow humans to see entirely new wavelengths of light. Imagine being able to see perfectly at nighttime by switching your vision to infrared mode. Or it could be possible to connect to the auditory nerve in order to play music direct to your brain. How crazy would it be to press play on your phone and immediately hear music without ever having to put on headphones? Neurotechnology is primarily used within the research and medical fields at this time. The most prominent uses include seizure detection and pain management. By using a technology called deep brain stimulation, people who suffer from Parkinson's disease can opt to undergo a surgery to be implanted with electrodes which stimulate the dopamine-producing areas of the brain. These devices help to mitigate the main symptom of Parkinson's, uncontrollable muscle tremors. Prosthetic limbs are also a significant use case for neurotechnology. Many robotic prosthetics have been developed in recent years that can mimic the ability to grip materials using electromyography, or muscle neuron signals. Implanted electrodes can be placed on the brain's motor areas to provide a more advanced prosthetic. The complexity of these prosthetics range from these simple gripper prosthetics to very complex, fully developed articulated fingers controlled by the brain directly. Communication has also been dramatically improved for people suffering from locked-in states. People in locked-in states are unable to move any part of their body. And until recently, they have relied solely on either eye blinks or eye tracking to communicate with the outside world. Now, with the advancement of more complex BCI systems, they are able to communicate much more quickly and clearly, either by using a brain-controlled thought keyboard or invoking a yes-no command by literally thinking yes or no. Communication is important for mental health of every person, and these devices have helped many find their voice again. The benefits of neurotechnology are clear. We have the potential to improve humanity by integrating our brains directly with technology. But as the field advances, multiple ethical questions are raised, such as, do using brain-computer interfaces make us more or less human? Could BCIs affect human evolution? Could humanity merge with AI? While these devices could benefit humanity, they could also bring about great risks. It's incredibly important to ask these questions now and discuss what could potentially go wrong as to avoid future humanitarian issues. Questions like, would it be possible to hack, influence, or control people's thoughts with neurotechnology? Would it be necessary to have a master control switch for people with implants that allow them to turn off these implants? And would technologies become so intertwined with the way that people think that they'd be impossible to turn off? Perhaps the most important ethical question, especially with consumer brain-computer interfaces, is can we trust corporations with our minds? What ethical issues could arise if an implanted neurotechnology used an advertisement model? Could they beam advertisements directly into your dreams? Could you be forced to experience an advertisement? We must ensure that neurotechnology is properly used to benefit humanity. And it's critically important that we address issues like this now while the technology is still in its infancy. Regardless of how long it takes to implement, it's clear at this point that neurotechnology will play a large role in the future of humanity. Future applications of neurotechnology already appear in media, although the realism of these devices may be up for debate. One example is in The Matrix. In this 1999 film, we see an excellent representation of how invasive neurotechnologies may allow for humans of the future to interact with an incredibly realistic simulation. This film brings into question whether or not our own reality may be simulated, and it's likely that in the future it may be impossible for us to distinguish reality from our advanced simulations. It also brings into question our own reality. After all, if reality can be so accurately simulated, who's to say that our current reality isn't? To recap, in this video we talked about what neurotechnology and brain-computer interfaces are. We also looked at how they're used, discussed ethical concerns of using these devices, and looked at how they may be used in the future. Thanks for sticking around, and we'll see you in our next video, where Harrison will discuss types of neurotechnology and the components of a BCI.